This is Mavulik. She's 5 years old. Mavulik's been unwell for months, and the hospital's doing a blood test to find out what's wrong. Her mother, Melina, is HIV positive, and the doctors think that Mavulik may be positive too. The results will be back in a few hours. Mavulik is being treated here at Chikankata Hospital in southern Zambia. The Salvation Army opened the hospital here in 1945. The hospital serves 85,000 people who live in the surrounding countryside. The lab is about to complete the HIV test on Mavulik's blood. Mavulik is HIV positive, one of the 6,000 people around the world who's infected every day. $25 million people have died from AIDS-related illnesses. 33 million people are today living with HIV and AIDS around the world. But most don't know they have it and may not know for years until the symptoms show. And in the meantime, they unwittingly put others at risk. There were 2.5 million new infections last year. 3/4 of the people living with HIV and AIDS are in sub-Saharan Africa. Zambia is one of the worst affected countries in the region. Today, 1 in 5 of the population is living with HIV. Chikankata has a long history of treating people with the disease. By the mid-1990s, the numbers of people who were dying from AIDS reached epidemic proportions. Salvation Army officers Dean and Iowin Pallant were based here at that time. Iowin worked as a doctor.
People were dying all the time. I was forever writing out death certificates. 99% of them were for people younger than myself. I was devastated. It affected everyone. There was nobody who was immune.
HIV is known mostly as a sexually transmitted disease, but it's also passed on by drug users sharing needles and through unscreened blood transfusions. A mother who is HIV positive can pass the disease on to her child during pregnancy, in childbirth, or through breastfeeding.
A lot of the diseases here are related to HIV, like maybe 70-80% of them. If you see that a child is taking so long to recover from a simple diarrhea, you suspect. So like if I don't know the status of the mums, I usually try to encourage them to get tested so that we know what we're dealing with.
The children are perhaps some of the most tragic victims of HIV. And so it's a specific target group to try and reach the pregnant mums, persuade them to be tested, to be put on treatment, to reduce the transmission to the children.
In 1996, new drugs called antiretrovirals, or ARVs, became available, but they were too expensive for developing countries. After 5 years of legal battles with the pharmaceutical companies, prices began to fall, and affordable drugs started to become available, but there's still a long way to go. Only a third of the 6 million people in developing countries who need ARVs get access to them. Patients at Chikankata are some of the lucky ones. The hospital now distributes ARVs to a growing number of patients. The manager of the community health and development team at the hospital is Charles Mangombe.
Actually, in the early days, when you were diagnosed, you were tested and you are HIV positive. I mean, there was no hope because there was nothing you could look at that would solve the problem. But I think with the introduction of ARVs, we are seeing a lot of hope because we are seeing people who are bedridden, working, and are economically viable again. And so this is the value that ARVs has added to the general population.
The provision of antiretrovirals has made a massive difference. It stops the virus multiplying, and therefore it slows the progression of the disease down, and people are now living 20, 30 years with the disease. That doesn't mean that people do not still become ill and die with HIV. So there is still need for care teams for those who are sick.
Alongside the role of treating those who already have the disease, the Salvation Army has put a lot of effort into prevention work, both in places where it's really taken hold and in parts of the world where HIV has yet to make an impact. This is Bangladesh. The nation gained independence from Pakistan in 1971, but widespread poverty and a run of natural disasters has meant the country has struggled. It's pretty much surrounded by India, whose booming economy has overshadowed its struggling neighbour. Jeshore is about 100 miles to the west of the capital, Dhaka, with a population of 250,000. The city centre has a long-established commercial sex industry. Sex workers are at high risk of infection from HIV, and even though levels here are still low, the city is not far from the border with India, which has much higher levels. So it may not take much to see a dangerous rise in infection rates. The Salvation Army team here runs a healthcare and counselling centre. Their office overlooks three of the city's largest brothels, where over 250 sex workers live and work. Victor Mondal is based in Dhaka, but has travelled here to see how the team is getting on.
No one was doing anything for these sex workers. They weren't getting health care or social care facilities. The government is supposed to provide these services in theory, but the reality is that the Salvation Army started to work here. And since then, we've been providing health care services, counselling and support. We were the first to take the civil surgeons around these brothels, and the sex workers were able to say that they needed condoms to protect themselves from HIV/AIDS. The Salvation Army has been here for 12 years.
This weekly support group is looking at health issues, and HIV and AIDS awareness is high on the agenda. Shushmita Biswas leads the Jeshore team.
People visit the brothel when they have a little extra cash. They come from the villages too. It could be a disaster if a lot of girls got infected with HIV. Not only for them, but also for the many people who would be infected through them. That's why we work to keep the girls safe. We try to promote awareness about HIV among the whole community.
The team includes Rani and Mina, who are both social workers. They make daily visits to the brothels. Over the last 12 years, the Salvation Army has got to know the girls who work here very well. They've even got to know the owners of the brothels. This means that they can reach the most vulnerable girls and offer support. Jasmine is 25 and has been working here for a couple of years. 2 weeks ago, she gave birth to a baby girl.
I feel terrible when I see a girl sacrificing her own identity just to survive and to give support to her family. I feel so sorry seeing these girls doing such an awful job. Bright girls who could get a higher education, a better life, and a brighter future, working in captivity like this.
Rani has a nursing background and does basic health checks for the women. Lippy is pregnant with her second child. She's due any day now, and the team are making sure she has everything in place for the birth.
We want these girls to leave this job. It's not an honourable job. God has created every human being. We are all precious. So we want these girls to come out of this life and start another profession and leave this one behind.
Helping the girls to leave the brothel is the main goal, but it's never simple. Most of the sex workers are in debt. Some are effectively owned by the madams and would be risking their lives if they try to escape. Shumi is 13. She's been here for 6 months. Rani and Mina have been visiting her for a few weeks now. Her madam was reluctant to allow her to be filmed until the crew agreed to compensate for her time.
None of the sex workers came to the brothel by their own choice. Many are forced, and some have no alternative. None of them want to be here, and if there was any way out of this hell, they would take it. But they can't, because they've been forced into debt, or they're threatened.
Finding ways to help the girls out of the brothel takes time. Shumi doesn't have HIV, but every day she's at risk. More people than ever are on the move, and some of them are carrying the HIV virus as they travel between cities, over borders, and across continents. This is the Mombasa Road in Kenya, the main transit route for a good part of East Africa's imports and exports, connecting the region's landlocked countries to the Indian Ocean. Truck drivers have been identified as key players in the spread of HIV, as the infection is carried along the main transport routes.
Some of the drivers just like going with girls. But you know us drivers. We could be away from home for a month, and during that time you may really want to have sex. If you have a condom, that's fine, but I don't use it.
We are on our way to Uganda. And when you're away from home, if you meet a beautiful girl, you might risk getting the virus. I do have friends who are positive, but you can't go around announcing you have the disease because some people are very afraid of AIDS.
The fear of HIV and AIDS means people keep it hidden from each other and communities remain silent. This is Kibera's slum in Nairobi, Kenya's capital city. Most people don't have access to running water, sanitation, or health facilities. And life expectancy is just 46 years old. It's estimated that a third of the city's population lives here. That's a million or so people. HIV infection is very high. As many as a quarter of Kibera's population is living with the disease. Major Rebecca Nzuki remembers when she first heard about the disease.
One man said, "Captain, we have a new disease here and we don't know it. We are worried about it." And that time, people did not know about HIV and AIDS. I had pain in my heart because I could see people dying. Nobody was talking.
As the disease took hold, the Salvation Army began to help people who were affected. The number of orphans began to grow, and Major Rebecca started supporting children too. The Salvation Army now runs a daily programme of activities for orphaned children. As well as offering basic education and a friendly, welcoming environment, the children are given a wholesome midday meal.
Some have no food. Some sleep without food, even water, because even water they buy. And they stay with the pain that their parents die. When they come together, those pains go out as they play together.
It's estimated that there are 100,000 orphans living in Kibera, And Kenya faces further challenges. Having seen a drop in infection rates over the last few years, the number of new infections has started to go up again. Stigma and discrimination against people with HIV is widespread and is actually helping to spread the disease. Breaking the stigma is part of the Salvation Army's mission. These days, Major Rebecca coordinates the Salvation Army's HIV/AIDS response throughout Kenya. Today, she's with a local facilitation team visiting a support group at the Salvation Army Corps here in the town of Makindu. Most of them belong to a church, and some are Salvationists. All the members of the group here are HIV positive. The group gives people a chance to share their experiences and talk freely about their illness. They have found that by being open about their status, they can break down the stigma around HIV.
The groups are very important because they share their challenges in life. Some, when they find they have HIV virus, they feel like killing themselves. So as they come together, they help each other to have hope in their life and to continue living, to take care of their children.
Today the group's rehearsing a drama, which they'll use with community groups and in schools to help people understand the disease and get them to talk about it. Pauline Nduku has been part of the group for 2 years.
You know, the stigma of HIV can kill a person. Because if you don't want people to know your status, you won't get medication, or people will know. Before I came here, life was very hard. I felt like I was going to die. I was really lonely and isolated. I had no one to talk to. But coming here, sharing with the group, life has become so much better.
Visiting is a central part of what the group does. Some of the people they visit are group members who are too ill to attend. Margaret Musumbi is a trained community counsellor from neighbouring Kithituni.
People keep dying. HIV/AIDS is killing us. We are left by our friends. They die. They leave behind their children or their wives or their widows. And those times are really difficult times for us.
Salome Masisa is 46 years old. She got diagnosed after her husband died from AIDS 5 years ago. She was left with her 6 children. The youngest, Esther, is just 7 years old and is also HIV positive.
Some of the people living with HIV/AIDS have been very ill and they're not able to do anything. They're just at their deathbed waiting to die, many of them. But after this home-based care and taking the drugs, they become strong again, then eat well. We know they can boost their immunity. They have been able to come out strong and live.
When I see teams going out, I feel happy. I give God the glory. It is our people, our children, our patients. Yeah, so I feel happy.
Amen. We are here to give hope to these people. people will share stories of how they have been through very hard times, but they have seen some light at the end of the tunnel.
The Salvation Army cares for people with HIV and AIDS throughout the world, treating people in hospitals and clinics and supporting them in their own communities. It's working to reduce the spread of HIV and to break down the stigma of the disease. Through its home-based care teams, the Salvation Army is helping to make life better for people living with HIV and AIDS.
Our message to people living with HIV AIDS is that this is not the end of the road. There's hope. They, as people, can live positively.
Hallelujah!